الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر
الله أكبر الله
لا إله إلا الله
لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما اعلموا عباد الله أن أحسن الكلام كلام الله تبارك وتعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم ما بعد عباد الله my dear brothers and sisters when Amr bin Salim al-Khuzai an ally to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam around the people of Mecca his tribe was just right outside Mecca and he was an ally to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he was attacked by another tribe who was an ally with the people of Mecca that was during the truce during the peace treaty the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had with the people of Mecca when he was attacked by one of the allies of the people of Mecca and they got casualties some of their members were killed He went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam seeking help. Now he's asking for the agreement that was fulfilled with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a year ago, a year before that. He was asking right now for this to be fulfilled. That, Ya Muhammad, we're your allies. We've been attacked. It's time for you to come and support us and help us. Give us that support and aid that you said you will if we were attacked. What was the response of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to this man? This man, he gave lines of poetry. He was speaking and he was kind of presenting his case to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, asking that Rasulullah will give him that support. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responded in just one word. He said, Nusrt. He says, you got that victory. He says, aid is provided. Just like that. Nusrt. Ya Amr ibn Salim. Means you got what you asked for. And the man just, he wrapped his stuff and he just went back again towards Mecca. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, few weeks later, he marches from Medina to Mecca with 10,000 warriors for the conquest of Mecca. That happened in Ramadan, the 10th. 10th of Ramadan, around that same time as we are right now, today. But that was 1400 years ago. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was very well known. To always be there for people who are in need. Regardless of the type of need that they were asking for, he was always there for them, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Even before he was commissioned for the prophethood, these were his qualities, salallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was always there to help people, عليه الصلاة والسلام, because he knew one of the meaning of being a human being, really, one of the meaning of being a human being is to be there for the needs of other human beings. So when Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he received the first revelation, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق, he went shivering home. He was so scared of that sight. It was unexpected. He went there, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he went straight to Khadija, his wife, radiallahu ta'ala anha wa ardaha, and he was asking her to cover him. Cover him. And he was asking, zammiluni, zammiluni, dathiruni, means cover me, wrap me up. And she was covering him, and she was wrapping him with his blanket, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then when he calmed down, she asked him, what was going on? And when he told her what he saw, he said, qala wallahi, laqad khashitu ala nafsi. I was so scared for myself. Means this is not regular moment. He said, I was so afraid. I was so scared for myself. But look at this woman, this lady. MashaAllah, amazing wisdom that comes from Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha when she recognized who that man was to her. Not just Muhammad, her husband, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No, he was someone who was very special. It's for those qualities that she chose him as a husband, radiallahu anha. She said, قَالَ كَلَّا وَاللَّهِ لَا يُخْزِيكَ اللَّهُ أَبَدًا. I swear by Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never disgrace you. Allah will never disgrace you. Remember, he wasn't a prophet. He wasn't a messenger yet. But she said, Allah will never disgrace you. إِنَّكَ لَتَصِلُ الرَّحِمُ. You always maintain the ties of kinship. You always good to your family. وَتَحْمِلُ الْكَلْ. And you bear the burden of the weak. وَتَكْسِبُ الْمَعْدُومُ. And you help the poor and the needy. وَتَقْرِ الضَّيْفِ. And you honor the guest. وَتُعِينُ عَلَى نَوَائِبِ الْحَقِّ. And you endure hardships in the path of truthfulness. Means you always help people regardless of the circumstances. So she recognized the Prophet ﷺ because of these qualities, charitable qualities of Rasulullah salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. In Islam, helping and assisting other people is a duty. It's a duty, is beyond just a human duty, is even a religious duty. What we see today in the Muslim world, what's happening in countries such as Gaza, now, so far, over 100 people were killed in the airstrikes. And also, number is increasing and increasing every single day. People, they're looking at the casualties, they start just counting numbers, not realizing that with the 100 people who were killed, there are hundreds of tens of houses were destroyed. Thousands of people were displaced in an area that is already congested anyway. So it's one of the greatest human atrocities that's been going on for over 60 years. And not so many people really are doing much about it. And even the hope that they were hoping to get from neighbor countries, Muslim countries, they're closing the doors, they're closing their borders against them again. We see similar happening in Iraq today, in Syria, and even in Burma every single day, Central Africa, in Bangladesh, in Kashmir, all over the world. All over the world, when you open the news, that's what news is for us. He's just reading about these atrocities, about these deaths, about these killings, and that's what unfortunately make news. And the help and assistance is not that much. Even in Iraq today, as people running away from the fighting that is happening there, there's more than 1 million refugees in the regions controlled in Kurdistan today. 1 million refugees. I was reading about this today. There isn't actually enough help and assistance. There's only one single organization that is trying to help. One single organization. International presence is completely unheard of over there yet. So 1 million people are there and waiting for someone to help them, subhanAllah, and there is nothing much to help for those people. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, man kana fi hajati akhi, fi hajati nas, كان الله في حاجته. Whoever puts himself in for the needs of people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of his own needs. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he ordered the people as we walk, as we sit sit outside our own houses even. He says, if you're going to put yourself in public place, then you better be careful, because you're going to be responsible for what happens out there. You're responsible for the safety of the public out there. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he asked, he says, don't sit in the streets. Don't sit out there in public places like that. So they said, ya Rasulullah, qalu wallahi ya Rasulullah, ma lana min majalisina min bud. These places where we sit, you know, these are the only places we have to gather and socialize. He said, if you're going to have to do that, if this is where you're going to have to sit down, qala fa'atu at-tariqa haqqa. Then you give the road its right. And they said, وَمَا حَقُّ الطَّرِيقِ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ What is the right of the road? He said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, إِغَاثَةُ الْمَلْهُوفِ One of it is to help and assist the needy. Anyone who's in need. If you see someone in the streets who's in need, you become responsible that you go and you assist and you help. وَتَهْدُ الضَّالِ And if someone asks for guidance on the road, that you also, you guide them through it. أَرَدُّ السَّلَامِ If someone says salam, that you say salam to them. So he counted, صلى الله عليه وسلم, many good deeds, many things. Becomes your responsibility if you choose to be in a public place like that. So even in your own neighborhood, even in your own neighborhood, you are responsible to help and assist in any way possible that you can, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he count this for us as a charity. This is not just a duty, it's also a rewarding duty. So when you help and assist other people, It's a rewarding duty. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ صَدَقَ Every single Muslim is obliged to give charity. He even said every single day. But then the concept of charity in Islam is beyond wealth and money. It goes beyond the money. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was asked, Ya Rasulullah, قَالَ فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ What if someone doesn't have money? If I don't have cash, how am I going to give charity? He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يَعْمَلُ بِيَدِهِ وَيَتَصَدَّقْ Then go and just do something handy, get some money out of that, and then just give in charity. So even you're obliged, almost, you could say, to go and find a job so you can earn money, so you can participate in helping other people. You help yourself by finding that job and helping other people when you provide that wealth and money. قَالُوا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ What if someone couldn't find a job, unemployed for so long? I don't even have money, I need that money. He said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, يُعِينُ ذَا الْحَاجَةِ الْمَلْهُوفِ Then at least help the one who's in need. At least give a hand. With your own hand, go and help somebody. So the concept of giving and helping is not just in money. In every way that you can. Every way that you can. Which explains for us now answering the question. Many people, they keep asking, what can I do? Well, I live in America over here. How can I do? How can I do something, you know, when I'm all the way thousands of miles away from the places like Gaza and other places in the Muslim world? How can I do it? Well, alhamdulillah, Allah blessed us with so many things. Bless us with wealth, with resources, bless us with technology, blessed with so many things so there is no excuse not to give or even give, whether it's money or give support or awareness or education in any way. You could still support these causes, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave us that the reward for this, it goes beyond this world, ya ikhwa. The reward for what you do to help and assist other people will go, inshallah ta'ala, beyond the reward in this world. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قَالَ وَمَنْ فَرَّجَ عَنْ مُسْلِمٍ كُرْبَةً مِنْ كُرَبِ الدُّنْيَا فَرَّجَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ كُرْبَةً مِنْ كُرَبِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ If anyone relieves that or alleviates the suffering of any people or anybody in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also alleviate the suffering for them on the day of judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ease their situation on the day of judgment. It's even much more rewarding to assist and help other people. It's more rewarding than i'tikaf. I know many of us right now plan, inshallah ta'ala, to do i'tikaf in this month of Ramadan, hoping that we will catch Laylatul Qadr. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who will catch Laylatul Qadr and will engage in ibadah and worship. So even i'tikaf, such a rewarding good deeds to detain yourself voluntarily in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the purpose of ibadah and worship until the end of the month of Ramadan. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَنْ مَشَى فِي حَاجَةِ أَخِيهِ مَنْ مَشَى فِي حَاجَةِ أَخِيهِ كَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ مِنْ اِعْتِكَافِ عَشْرِ سِنِينَ That if you walk with somebody to help them, help someone to relieve them from a hardship, or help them fulfill a specific, let's say, obligation, or help them in their needs, and so on. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that's better, that's more rewarding than doing i'tikaf for 10 years. Doing i'tikaf 10 years, because i'tikaf will benefit you, and only you. But helping other people, you might not just benefit that individual in particular. No, an extended family perhaps would be benefited from that thing that you just do to them. So keep in your mind in this month of Ramadan, as part of your good deeds, as you focus on your fasting, as you focus on your salah, as you focus on your ibadah, that part of this is also to be charitable, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Now, being charitable, it is for us the path of the anbiya. It's not just, you know, the path of the good, righteous Muslims. It's the path of the anbiya and the prophets themselves. Let's take example of some of those prophets, alayhim salatu wassalam. Ibrahim, alayhi salam. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was very well known for a very unique quality, his generosity. He was one of those most generous people you can think of. Even in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the story of the three angels who came in human forms, and they were passing by the area of Ibrahim alayhi salam, going to the Qawm Lut to fulfill the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of punishing these people. But on their way, they stopped by, and Ibrahim alayhi salam, he immediately invited them over. And when he invited them over alayhi salam, he offered them a great feast, an entire cow for food. And they were only three people. But he knew that they were strangers. He knew that they were just passing by. He knew that they were not from around. And he, being the messenger of Allah, the prophet, still he would dedicate that time to go and help these people. Come over here and invite them over for food, alayhi salam. That is Ibrahim alayhi salam. Musa, Prophet Musa alayhi salam, he was running away from the Pharaoh. He was running away. And he kept running and going far away until he passed the territories of the Fir'aun, when he was almost safe over there. He didn't know he was safe yet, but eventually he was still running away from the danger. And then at some point he had to rest somewhere. So he rested under the shade of a tree. And he was resting under the shade of a tree and he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Eventually he sees in that area there was an oasis. So the water source was now being covered by all these shepherds. They're coming to bring in their camels, their sheep and so on for the water. He saw two ladies. Two ladies, they have few sheep with them, and they were holding their sheep back. And he was looking at them and wondering, why aren't they approaching the water, knowing that the water is full with all these men shepherds, and why isn't there any men with them to help them out? So he immediately volunteered. He volunteered. He went physically there, walked to them, and he says, why are you waiting here? What exactly are you waiting here for? قَالُوا لَا نَسْقَى لَتَى لَا نَسْقِي حَتَّى يَسْقِي الرِّعَى. We're not going to take our animals there until all the shepherds are done, because they don't want to mix with men. SubhanAllah, look at this beautiful quality of shyness and bashfulness at that moment. So they said, we're not going to get mixed with these men. Wait until they finish. So Musa alayhi salam, he himself volunteered to help them out. He says, I'll take care of this for you. And Musa was a strong man. Musa was raised in the house of the Pharaoh. So he had, mashallah, a very strong build, that when he pushed that man, he just killed him. And it's for his, because he was always there for the need of people, he got in trouble. So then when he ran away and he went there and he helped these ladies, and then eventually after they took their sheep when they went back home, it seems that their father, he was surprised that they arrived earlier than usual. But when they told him the story that we met this gentleman and he did so and so, he sent one of his daughters to him. He said, my dad wants to talk to you. And as he went there with her and he was walking, then he told him his story. He says, don't worry, you're safe in this area. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alleviated instantly the suffering of Musa alayhi salam. For 10 years he was living in safety alayhi salatu was salam. Can you imagine how instant the response of the dua of Musa alayhi salam was? Literally answered right away after that. By the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was helped and he was saved. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was always there for the needs of people. He was known to help the men, women, the children, anyone who come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, Ya Rasulullah, give me this, he will give it to him. Anybody. He would never say no to anybody, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A woman gave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a nice suit. She gave him a nice thobe that she saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, perhaps he needed a new one. So she made one for him and she gave it to him. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very happy and excited. He wore it the next salah. So when he came out in the musalla, after he finished his salah, another man, he saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wearing it. He said, Ya Rasulullah, this is very nice. Can I have it? Allahu al-musta'an. I mean, he just, the first time he puts it on, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this man comes and says, Ya Rasulullah, can I have this? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, sure. When I go home, I'll take it off and I'll send it to you, inshallah. And he did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even the companions, the sahaba who were around this man, when the Prophet left, they start scolding this man. Says, woe to you. Didn't you know the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would never say no to anybody? How dare you ask him for this when he needed it himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the man, he gave his excuse. He says, you know what? I only asked for this because I needed this to be my kafan, my shroud when I die. I want something the Prophet ﷺ touched. I mean, you could say he could have asked for something old, but eventually he took his chance and he got it. The point here is that the Prophet ﷺ didn't tell the man, well, honestly, this is new. If you want, I can give another one. He didn't say that. He said, sure, you got it. He was always charitable ﷺ to this level. Rasulullah ﷺ was known that an older woman come to him and she would grab him by hand. She would grab his hand ﷺ. She said, I want you to help me with something. Now we don't know, some of the narrations say they didn't even recognize that he was Muhammad ﷺ, the messenger. And some other they said that she knew. Eventually, he would go with her. He would walk with her anywhere she wanted. He said, take me any streets of Medina, I'll go with you until you finish your hajjah, until you finish your need. So he would go and he helped these ladies, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then when he was done, he goes back again to mind his own things, salawatullahi wa sallamu alayhi. Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even in Mecca, in these difficult situations, when he was harassed by the people of Mecca, people, they would still come to him and say, could you please keep this with you until I come back from my journey? And he will keep it for them. And they will come, says, now people of Mecca are so oppressors that they oppressed me. I need my money. The Prophet ﷺ himself would walk to Abu Jahl, his enemy, and others. And he would ask them to make sure that they give this man his haqq and his rights, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be charitable and to be there for the need of other people. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, تَرَى الْمُؤْمِنُ فِي تَوَادِّهِمْ وَتَرَحِمْهُمْ كَمَثَلِ الْجَسَدِ. That the example of the believers, the example of one body, one single body, means in terms of their mercy for one another, for to take care of one another, just like the body. إِذَا اشْتَكَى مِنْهُ عُضْوٌ تَدَعَى لَهُ سَائِرُ الْجَسَدِ بِالسَّهَرِ وَالْحُمَّى. If one part aches, the entire body will ache as a result of that. If you have just a tooth pain, you couldn't go to sleep. If your foot starts hurting, subhanAllah, the entire body starts reacting to this. This is exactly the example of this ummah. And when you see some sort of suffering happening anywhere in the world, no, wallahi, not just in the Muslim ummah, in the Muslim world, anywhere in the world, you as a believer, you should be the first person to feel the pain of other people. Why? Because the Messenger of Allah was sent as rahmatan lil alameen. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةَ الْعَالَمِينَ. We have sent you, Muhammad, but mercy to mankind. Mercy to the world. He was sent as a mercy to the world, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is not here with us right now. But his message, his legacy as being mercy to the world, salawatullah wa salam alayhi, should continue in his followers in the Muslim ummah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one time he was in Medina in the masjid when a group from Ghafar, a tribe that came from outside Mecca, Medina. And there, when he looked at them, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he immediately could see in his face how he was completely unpleased by that sight. They were so poor, they're so thin, didn't have clothes, so we're just in a very, very difficult situation. And he didn't like that sight, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They didn't even have to talk to him. They didn't even speak to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam yet. They just arrived in Medina because of a famine, because of a condition that they run through in the desert. So they arrived into an urban area in the city. So they landed over there, and when the Prophet, he saw their conditions, he immediately volunteered, without even them requesting anything from him. He volunteered, and he went on the minbar, and he gave that public announcement for the ummah to give and support these people. He said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, تصدق رجل من ماله, تصدق رجل من درهمه, تصدق رجل من صاعه, من مده. Let the person give from his money, from his wealth, from your gold, from your silver. Give from the food that you have. Give from anything. He said, the mud, which means a handful, whatever that you can afford to give. Just give for these people. And then a man right away, he went home and he brought a surra, which means a big, huge bag or sack. It was so heavy that he couldn't even carry it himself, that people had to jump and help him out. So when the people, they saw the generosity of this one individual, they all rushed, and they all tried to help as well. So when the Prophet, he saw the piles of food and wealth coming from all over in front of him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was so pleased at the response of the Muslim ummah for crises like these. These crises, unfortunately, they don't finish, they don't end. They're continuous. And one of the things that we have is, as you see in the Muslim world today, these are crises that we are all responsible as much as possible to help ease the situation for other people around the world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who listen to the speech and follow the best of it. And may Allah make us among those who follow the example of the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه إنه الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا ثم أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters, one of the causes I'm very really passionate about, and I've worked in this field for many years when I was very young, as a teenager even, is the subject of orphans and widows. You know, as a result of what we see in this world, I don't know if you really count the numbers, but subhanAllah, for every single man who is killed almost, every single man who is killed in one of those battles, one of those wars, there are at least 2-3 children left without any support, any help. For every single man who dies. Just last week, there was also a report, an international report, coming about the condition of Syrian women. The Syrian women, the refugees, how hard it is for them. Imagine, this is not for 1 year, it's not 2 years, it's over 3 years already they've been going through this, and every single day there are more casualties happening, which means more orphans are left without fathers, and some of them are left without even mothers, on their own. I read stories about kids that were picked up from the streets because the house was destroyed. The entire neighborhood was wiped out completely. And these kids were wandering, they don't even know, they don't even understand what happened. Their mind could not even register what exactly happened around them. They have to be picked up by strangers from the neighborhood, and they were taken to shelters and then eventually to move to refugee camps and so on, and they're left on their own. These kids, they grow up without having fathers, mothers around them. They're growing up, subhanAllah, and I don't know how the world looks like for them in the future. And the same thing happens all over the world. Not just in Iraq, not just in Syria, not just in Gaza, all over. These places, every single time you hear about a man is killed, I want you to keep that in your mind. Every time you hear about that, it means there's an orphan who was left without a father, without someone to take care of them. I'm very passionate about taking care of orphans. Alhamdulillah, when I was very young, I was responsible. I was like the secretary of one of these organizations that cared for orphans only. And I have seen the generosity of people. I've seen the generosity of these people. I've seen the generosity of merchants. Some of them, they used to sponsor 200 orphans. And I used to build them based on the invoice myself every single month. And I've seen people, mashallah, sponsoring 50, 10, even I've seen people just sponsoring at least one orphan. And because they knew that from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the value of supporting and sponsoring these orphans, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, أنا وكافر اليتيم كهاتين. He says, I will be in the day of judgment, me and the sponsor of an orphan like this. The proximity, being so close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she's like, we will be like this, very close in Jannat al-Firdaus, Allahumma ja'alna minhum. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he also said that the one who is taking care of the al-qaim al-yatim wal-armal wal-miskin, the one who sponsors the orphans, the widows, he said with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is better than as-sa'im al-qaim alladhi la yaftur. In reward, it's better than someone who's constantly fasting every single day, constantly praying Qiyamul Layl every single night, because you're taking care of the needs of these people. Islamic Relief is actually after Salatul Jum'ah, inshallah ta'ala, will be here in front of you for a few minutes, bidnillahi azza wa jal, asking you for this particular cause, that you sponsor these orphans and taking care of their needs. I usually, and you know me actually, I usually don't do fundraisings other than my masjid, my community, and if there is a passionate cause that I'm actually looking for, such as orphans over here. And I would like from you, inshallah ta'ala, to wait for a few minutes and show your support to Islamic Relief, inshallah ta'ala, after Salatul Jum'ah, and give generosity to this beautiful cause sponsoring these orphans. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make you among those who will be close to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Jannat al-Firdaus. Allahumma alimna ma yinfa'na, wa anfa'na bima alamtana, innaka anta al-alimul hakeem. Allahumma aati nufusana taqwaha, wa zakkiha anta khayru man zakkaha. أنت وليها مولاها عباد الله إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وارض اللهم عن خلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر الصحابة أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. هيا على الصلاة، هيا على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
استووا استقيموا للصلاة، يرحمكم الله. إن شاء الله. Okay. If the brothers please, between the blue line and the wall, please, no one should be praying. If you don't mind, go all the way back. We have two extra rooms, inshallah, on the right side and the left side. So you have two rooms for overflow. Please do not block the walkway. Don't pray between the blue line and the wall. Jazakumullah khairan. So for the brothers who are standing there, if anyone is standing next to you, cross a past that blue line, please make sure to ask them to go back. Jazakumullah khairan. Istaqimu lassalah, yarhamkumullah. الله أكبر. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، تبارك اسمك، تعالى الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى الذي خلق فسوى، والذي قدر فهدى، والذي أخرج المرعى فجعله غثاء أحوى. سنقرئك فلا تنسى إلا ما شاء الله، إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخفى. ونيسرك لليسرى، فذكر إن نفعت الذكرى. سيذكر من يخشى ويتجنبها الأشقى، الذي يصلى النار الكبرى ثم لا يموت فيها ولا يحيا. قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى، بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى. إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى، صحف إبراهيم وموسى. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. والضحى والليل إذا سجى، ما ودعك ربك وما قلى، وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى ألم يجرك يتيما فآوى ووجدك ضالا فهدى ووجدك عائلا فأغنى فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنهر وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله. اللهم أنت السلام ومنك السلام. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Before I give that microphone to Brother Busif, inshallah, for the on behalf of Islamic Relief, I just want to remind you that for those brothers and sisters who signed up for the iftar sponsorship, please make sure to stop by the office, inshallah, to pray. Sheikh Muhammad Jibril will be, inshallah, in Valley Ranch Islamic Center this Sunday night for Salat al-Qiyam and Salat al-Taraweeh, inshallah, ta'ala, Salat al-Taraweeh, the entire night.